fire and smoky mist. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts may be acceptable in your sight. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hopefully our lives have happy days. Since I just returned from vacation, I had a number of happy days on vacation, which of course culminated in seeing my son graduate from college. Now, I was really surprised how happy that day was for me, because my own graduations never meant much to me, whether it was high school, college, or seminary. By the time I graduated, I was always interested in looking forward to what was coming than back on what had been. In fact, for my high school graduation, graduated from a large 6A high school, and we were going to have the graduation in the gym, and it was going to be hot, especially in the robes. I asked my mom, since they were mailing us the diplomas anyway, could I just skip the graduation ceremony? I got an earful about that. I was reminded that all four of my grandparents were coming in from out of state, and other family and friends were coming to see the graduation ceremony, and if I didn't want to do it for me, I should do it for everyone else. I quickly learned I would be going through the graduation ceremony. So I was surprised at how meaningful it was to watch my son graduate, and I could begin to understand why my mom was a little horrified that I didn't want to go through graduation so many years before. Happy days. Hopefully we have a lot of them. About a couple weeks before we went on vacation, I was watching the NFL Network, and they had a show on it about the Denver Broncos' first Super Bowl victory. And Hannah was watching this show with me, and she could tell, the more excited I got, how happy I was when they finally won a Super Bowl. And so she asked me about it, and I tried to explain to her the years of frustration that were prior to that Super Bowl, how when I started watching the Broncos, they were a horrible team, and there was no way they were going to get to the Super Bowl. And then they had one magical year in 77 where they appeared to be the team of destiny. They got to the Super Bowl only to be crushed by the Dallas Cowboys. But I thought, no problem, they'll get there again. Well, the years passed, the talent went away, and it didn't look like they were going to get back to the Super Bowl anytime soon. And then a miracle happened. The Denver Broncos acquired the rights to John Elway, who was picked by the Colts in the first in the NFL draft. And it's a lot easier to get to the Super Bowl with a Hall of Fame quarterback than without one. So that finally, we're going to get back to the Super Bowl and win. Sure enough, in about 3 years, the Broncos were back in the Super Bowl. I thought, ah, this is our year. And they were winning at halftime. And then the third quarter occurred, and the Giants scored a whole bunch of points, and it turned into a blowout. I thought, oh, there's always next year. Next year, they were right back in it against the Washington Redskins, and they were the favorites that year. And they were up 10-0 in the first quarter, and I thought, finally, this is the year. And in the second quarter, the Redskins scored more points in a quarter than any other team in Super Bowl history, and it turned into one of the greatest routs in Super Bowl history. That one was a little tough to take, but I thought, we'll be back. In a few years, they were against the San Francisco 49ers, and that game was close right up until they kicked off the game at the very start. San Francisco Niners put a beating on the Broncos that was the worst Super Bowl defeat in history. And then the years started dwindling away, and the talent went away, and Elway was getting to the end of his career, and I thought, oh, this is just never going to happen. I'm never going to see it in my lifetime. And then they got into the playoffs as a wild card. They made it all the way to the Super Bowl, but they were playing the Packers, and they were a 14-point favorite. And I got to admit, as a Bronco fan, I didn't think they were going to win that game. I was hoping they at least wouldn't get blown out, but I didn't think they won, and they won. And so I was trying to explain to Hannah that 20 years of frustration, 20 years of seeing the greatest Super Bowl blowouts in history were all erased on that one magic day. So she said, Dad, that was obviously a happy day for you. So where does it rank in your life? I said, it was probably the third best day of my life. And she said, well, your birth of your two children probably ranked ahead. I said, yes. And then she thought about it, and she started getting a little indignant. She said, well, what about your marriage to Mom? And I knew whatever I told her, she was going to tell Melissa. So I said, as wonderful as that day was, it probably ranks after that first Super Bowl victory. And Hannah started getting really upset, and I said, oh, you got to give me credit, though. It ranks before their second Super Bowl victory the next year. Sure enough, she went and told Melissa exactly what I said, and she came back and told me what Melissa responded. And Melissa said, well, if he told anything else, he would have been lying. Hopefully our lives are filled with happy days, whatever happy days they may be. Our New Testament lesson is filled with what should be a happy day, a very happy day for us and the Christian church. In fact, it should be the happiest day in the entire Christian year. Now, we do a lot more in terms of getting ready for Advent and Christmas than we do in Pentecost. And there's good reason for that. Looking back at the birth of our Savior into this world, looking back in the past can teach us all sorts of important lessons. It's also sacred history. It's part of our salvation. It's important. But when we look back in the Advent and Christmas season, we're looking back in events that are in the past, the ancient past. And they are events that were wrought either by God in his birth in this world or the people who helped that come about. That story is about other people. We also, of course, make a big deal about Jesus' resurrection for good reason on Easter. That's a very important day. But once again, that is a day in the past. And it's about what someone else did, what Jesus Christ did for us in dying for our sins so we could be set free. Again, it's ancient history. It's good to look back on it, but it is still ancient history. Now, you might be sitting there and thinking, well, if you're reading this passage from Acts, that's got to be ancient history as well. And it is from one perspective. For the people in our New Testament lesson from Acts, it is ancient history. The apostles and disciples were gathered together about 50 days after Jesus' resurrection. Jesus had ascended about 10 days earlier, and as they were sitting around, they heard the sound of a violent wind, it says, and then these tongues of fire came and rested upon each one of them, and they suddenly were able to speak in other languages. And when the Jews who were gathered at a particular religious festival from all over the Roman world heard this, they were amazed, because they were all hearing the story of Jesus in their own native tongue. And so they were wondering, what are we witnessing? What kind of amazing miracle are we witnessing in our own day? Of course, as always, there's some in the crowd that had to sneer and say, oh, they're just drunk. You can kind of understand that, because if the only language you hear is one language and all the rest of them you can't understand, maybe you think they might just be drunk. But Peter stood up and he took his stand, not just for God, but for people to understand what was going on. This was one of the moments for which he was born into the world. And he began to explain to them what was happening. He said, these people are not drunk, as some of you are saying, but this is the fulfillment of what God promised so long ago by the prophet Joel. God said, in the last days, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, upon your sons and daughters, and they will prophesy. And he said, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. God says, even upon my men and women, even upon the slaves, I will pour out my spirit, and they will prophesy. Peter was telling them, this is the moment that God has moved all of human history to. This is the most important moment in all of human history. And it is a day that we should celebrate, not only as a church, but as individual followers of Jesus Christ above any other day. Why? Why should this day be so special? Because as we look back at the ancient history of this story, it's not just the story of other people. It's not just a story of what God did for us so long ago on this day, it's also our story. It's not just a story about the past, but it's a story about our present and the story about every one of our days moving forward into the future. The story of Pentecost is our story as well. It's not about what others did in following God. It's not about what God did in saving us. It's about our story with God right here, right now, and moving forward. Why is Pentecost such a wonderful day? The first reason is because each one of us now has the gift of the Holy Spirit. It has been poured out upon you and has been poured out on me. And it's been poured out in a measure that only occurred very rarely in human history before the day of Pentecost. Only the spiritual elite received the Holy Spirit. And then of the spiritual elite, only a few received the Holy Spirit so that it rested with them for their entire lives. Few people like Moses and Elijah, people like the major prophets, people like the apostles, these are the kind of individuals who had the Spirit for any time in their lives prior to the day of Pentecost. The first reason the day of Pentecost should be such a happy day for us is because God pours out his Spirit upon us, not on our merit, not because of what we have done, but because through Jesus Christ in the sight of God, we are sinless, and his righteousness is imputed to us. And so the Spirit of God can come upon us as if we are sinless. The first reason we should be excited about the day of Pentecost is because the Spirit has been given to us in the same way it was to those spiritual greats so long ago. We have the Holy Spirit in the very same measure that they did, and even as the apostles, even as Moses and Elijah. The second reason that we should be so happy about this day, as we look back in the ancient scriptures, we see that there were times when the Holy Spirit came upon people and then it left them. There's no way to read the story of Saul without shedding a few tears about how Saul had the Holy Spirit, about how he felt the presence of God, and then it was taken from him. And he was grieved to the core of his soul for the rest of his life because he was searching for that which he would never get back, and that was the Spirit, because of his sins. A second reason we should be so excited about this day is because in Jesus Christ, we are promised that the Spirit will be with us always. That's what Jesus means when he tells us, "Lo, I am with you always to the close of the age." We not only receive the Spirit, but in a way that we can't lose it. We can't lose it the way Saul lost it. We can't lose it the way Balaam lost it. We can't lose it the way other prophets lost it because of their sin. Not only is it poured out upon us in such great measure, but we have the promise that it can never, ever be taken away in Jesus Christ. And a third reason we should be so excited about this day is that with the gift of the Holy Spirit, we are now empowered. We have been given everything that we need to complete the tasks for which we were born into this world. In the same way, the infinite presence of God rested upon Moses and Elijah so they could stand forth for why they entered the world. In the same way, Peter stood up in our New Testament lesson and was able to stand up for the very things he came to this world. We have the Spirit of God. You and I have the Spirit of God in such measure that the infinite presence of God rests upon us to give us whatever we need, to empower us however we need to do exactly what we came into this world. We have the infinite presence of God. There is no problem. There is no situation. There is no stumbling we can do. There is no failing that we can do in life. There is nothing that can prevent that infinite presence of God from giving us exactly what we need to do what we were born into this world to do. As we look back at the day of Pentecost, it is an incredibly happy day, and it should be probably the most happy day for us, not only as a church in celebrating it, but as individual Christians following Jesus Christ, because we are now promised the Spirit without measure. We are now promised the Spirit in a way that it can never be taken away, and we are promised with that Spirit everything that we need to serve God, everything we need to be holy, everything we need to love other people, everything we need to love ourselves in the way God wants us to. Everything we need is available to us through the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you so much for the gift of your presence, a presence that will be with us always. In your holy name we pray. Amen.